Freedom of employment, does it really exist? Join Steve Drazkowski and me next to hear lots more. I'm Sue Jeffers for Libertarian Viewpoint. Libertarianism is all about liberty, the exercise of freedom that doesn't impinge on the rights of others. We constantly hear the drumroll of government solutions. This show's purpose is to allow you to see for yourself why non-government solutions are a better alternative. Today, our guest is Steve Drazkowski. Hi, Steve. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
And we should tell the viewers that you are a Minnesota House representative, and you're from the Wabasha area.
Yes, I'm from Wabasha County. Actually, I live in the western part of Wabasha County at Mazeppa.
Okay.
Population 842, Sue.
Population 842. Okay, so you're about an hour and a half south of the cities?
About that, yes.
Yes. And you've been in the legislature for how long?
I'm actually in my fourth year, so third term.
Oh, excellent. Mm-hmm. Okay, so last legislative session, you were there when Tim Pawlenty was governor and the Democrats had the majority. Mm-hmm. Now, it's different this year. We have Mark Dayton sitting in the governor's chair, and the Republicans are in the majority. What did you think of last session?
Well, it's really quite a bit different. We spent the first two terms that I was in the legislature guarding the goal of freedom, if you will, Sue. And what we're seeing now is really some opportunity for us to enact legislation that will maybe recapture some of the freedoms that have been taken away from us over time. And so we're hoping to do more of that this session, actually. Last session was really encumbered. The majority of it was around the budget, and rightfully so. It was a budgeting year, the first year of the biennium. And the bulk of that discussion and the bulk of the air in the room belonged to the budget. And so we did have some reforms in that budget. There were really good reforms. Not very widely talked about, though. But incidentally, those reforms in last year's budget were able to bend the cost curve in the 14-15 biennium by $2.5 billion, something that's not really talked about, but something certainly as we go into the next session and look at our Reform 2.0 measures that we're looking at, opportunities for us to do more of the same, decrease the cost of government and take it out of the lives of people and businesses so that they can operate again.
So I think a lot of people don't understand or never knew that the state of Minnesota operates on a two-year budget. So the first year is the budget year, the second year is the bonding year. So last year, the session went pretty well. Mark Dayton vetoed everything except for the agricultural bill. And then we ended up with the state shutdown, correct?
We did.
And you still had a lot of people who were really upset about how much money you spent. The budget was way too big.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, the budget that we passed was $34.4 billion plus another $1.5 billion of one-time spending, largely from borrowing. And as we look at the biennium before, you could argue whether that spending was at about $30.5 billion or maybe a $32.5 billion budget, but certainly a full 6 or 12% less than the recurring biennial budget that we passed just back in July for the current biennium we're in. So you're right. We grew government by 12 or 13% at this point, depending on how you measure the numbers, and certainly not the direction we need to be going. However, certainly remember, we've got the most liberal governor probably in the history of Minnesota sitting in the governor's chair. His initial proposal was upwards of 20 or 22% increase in the cost of the budget, or actually a 22% budgetary increase was proposed, and we at least came a long ways closer to zero from there, which if it's any consolation. But
not much. I
and others certainly in the legislature were hoping to spend either the same as a previous biennium or even less, and we didn't accomplish that goal.
Yes, no matter who you talk to, the right side of the aisle, the left side of the aisle, everybody agrees that the state of Minnesota, well, except for Mark Dayton, everybody agrees that we're spending too much money. Mm-hmm. I think people get that. So next legislative session is a bonding year. That means we're going to borrow even more money. And the state of Minnesota has, I believe, $1.9 billion left before they cap out their borrowing limit. Do you think we're going to cap it?
Well, I don't even know if we're going to have a bonding bill, Sue. We had a $497 million bonding bill as part of the solution, if you will, that was agreed
to last year.
Excellent point. We've already had one in this biennium, and a good number of us are going to be saying, you know what, we had our bonding bill, we funded our not little, huge projects around the state of Minnesota. It's time to give a break to the taxpayers, because we have to remember bonding, debt service that pays off the bonding is the very fastest growing part of the state budget. We're approaching $1.2 billion. We will have passed $1 billion in debt service for the first time in the history of our state, fastest growing part of the state budget. We've already got $6.3 billion of bonding debt to pay off. Let's give it a break and go on to some other types of reforms.
Did you say $1 billion in debt service?
$1.2 billion in debt service each biennium. Yes, that's part of our biennial budget.
That's staggering, and that's a number we need to get out there lot more often. I wanted to ask you, before we get into why I brought you here today, I want to ask you about these reforms that you made that have adjusted the spending curve. Mm-hmm. Can you, they don't get enough attention. Can you say a little bit about that?
Well, a lot of them were in the Health and Human Services area. As we know, Health and Human Services, incidentally, was projected in the 14-15, the next biennium, to increase by about 22%, yet in the biennium that we haven't gotten to yet. And because of these reforms, we were able to bend that down to about 5% growth rather than 22%. So some amazing work. And a lot of that was done around some of the eligibility for many of the Health and Human Services programs. We provide some reforms and limits to eligibility. We also applied for some waivers from the federal government in order to do that. Those are built in there. But it's largely the Health and Human Services area. Incidentally, we were able to repeal the sick tax. We repealed a tax last year in the Minnesota legislature, albeit that it's going to take until 2018 to phase out. But the legislation, it's in statute, it's in law, it's going to each year ratchet down until it evaporates in 2018. So some good stuff happened.
So I think a lot of people don't know that 2% sick tax, we all pay that. Mm-hmm. It's a tax on our medical expenses.
Exactly.
And that was a huge win, and you're right, not enough people hear about that either.
It was.
So what are we looking forward to next legislative session? What's on the horizon?
Well, I think many people in Minnesota have heard about Reform 2.0. We talked about some of those reforms that happened last session. We collectively look at those and refer to them as Reform 1.0. In other words, that was the first effort at reform. Again, some good stuff in that package. We went around Minnesota over the last several months, have gotten some input from them on what are some additional reforms you'd like to see to shrink the size of government, to bring government to be more accountable to the people again. We know, unfortunately, it's been the other way around for so long. So we gathered a lot of that input over the last 3 months, and now we're assembling that and coming forward. We'll have a series of bills that we will be rolling out in a package that is going to be referred to as Reform 2.0. We'll be bringing forward early in the session reforms that will make government smaller, make it more accountable, take government out of the lives of families and businesses so that they can work and hire people and we can return to prosperity again.
I'll be waiting for my phone call, because I have a long list of suggestions that I would like to see in front of the legislature next year. I'll be happy to come and testify too. I'm always highly entertaining.
We will be calling you.
All right. So one of the big things that I want to see coming is something that's called right to work. A lot of people don't understand what that means. So do you want to give us a little recap?
Well, in Minnesota, we have basically forced unionism, Sue, which means if it's a closed shop type of workplace, in that whether you're talking about a public workplace in a public employer, like say the Department of Natural Resources, or federally, they actually require the same type of approach in the private workplace, and that means that if your workplace has voted in the past to become a union, if the employees have voted to become a union, every employee is a compulsory union member. In other words, they are forced to pay the union dues, which are significant withdrawals from their paychecks, either pay the union dues or fair share, which basically means 85 or 90% of union dues. You can pay those, but then you don't get health insurance and some other things through your union. But so what Right to Work does, and incidentally, there are 22 states in the U.S. that have Right to Work, almost half. And a good number of them have Right to Work in their constitutions. I think it's 8 or 9, about half of those have Right to Work in their constitution. And we are proposing it here in Minnesota, and I introduced the bill last session. It's House File 65. What it would do is it would provide a measure up to place it on the ballot for the voters to give them the ability to adopt Right to Work here in Minnesota. We call it freedom of employment, employee freedom, if you will, which gives the worker the ability and the freedom to decide whether or not they want to become a union member. It does nothing about the collective bargaining process. The union can still collectively bargain with their employer, but not everyone has to become part of the union. And that can be significant for people. We're looking at some of these professional folks who are members of unions. They're paying $600, $700, $800 a year in dues. So if we can have Right to Work or freedom of employment adopted by the voters here in Minnesota, that could be a significant increase in wages for those folks. And you know, we need to move towards freedom of association in the marketplace.
So it's clear you must hate unions.
Oh, not at all. Not at all. The other part about this is it's a two-way freedom. It not only does it allow workers the freedom to decide whether or not they want to join a union, but it also says to employers that you cannot decide to not hire somebody because they have outwardly said that they want to be a member of a union. So it's a two-way freedom. This is all about freedom, freedom of association, freedom for people to direct their future according to our U.S. Constitution. So really that's what it's about, and the people in Minnesota are really getting excited about this from what I've been hearing out there, some of the polling data we've seen. So I'm excited to see if we can bring this forward and place it on the ballot for the people of Minnesota.
So there are public unions and private unions. Does this apply to both?
It does, yes. Yep, it would apply to all unions in the state of Minnesota. And again, it's been passed in other states. And
I think Scott Walker in Wisconsin just signed Wisconsin, which means we're surrounded. If you look at the map, everyone around us is a Right to Work state except for the state of Minnesota.
The two Dakotas, Iowa, and now Wisconsin, Sue. So it's us in Ontario, eh?
Yes.
So we are finding ourselves surrounded, and not only that, the important thing about this, we need to remember the strength about Right to Work or freedom of employment. The good thing about it is that the job creation that evolves out of states that have freedom of employment happens at a rate of 2 times that of states that do not. And so we look back in history and we can look at different periods of years, and it's very evident, not only job creation, but in a variety of other economic measures, we're seeing that it's a great thing for the worker, it's a great thing for business, it's a great thing for the overall economy. This is a huge jobs bill that will become, that if we can get it placed on the ballot, and I have no doubt the people of Minnesota will pass it if it's placed on the ballot. If that happens, this will be the biggest job creation strategy that the state legislature in Minnesota could do.
Why do you think it has to be placed on the ballot?
Well, some of that is self-evident. We have a governor in Minnesota that is a very strong friend of unions. He worked very closely with unions through the election, and as a matter of fact, he. And when we talk about unions with Right to Work, and we can go into some of the numbers later, but really union members are in favor of this. It's the union bosses that are opposed to right to work because they're afraid of losing their command and control and political power.
And money.
And money, and that's where the political power comes from. But that political power certainly was exercised last election between, especially, you know, AFSCME and MAPE and the public unions and our governor. So he's reluctant to sign any statutory measure that would bring freedom of employment around. As a matter of fact, he vetoed many reforms around labor last session as part of our reforms in Reform 1.0. So anyway.
So we already have at least one constitutional amendment question on the ballot. Can you ever have too many? Is it a good idea to have multiple questions on the ballot? And any other questions that you think might be added onto the ballot as well?
Well, I would suspect you can have too many. As a matter of fact, I have seen a past piece from Minnesota House Research that has done the research around the correlation between the number of ballot measures that are placed out there for the people and the probability with which, or the correlation, I should say correlation is probably the right term, with which they may be passed at that point. And we find, as we look back, those years in which there were two, three, or four ballot measures placed on the ballot had a significantly greater success than either one or five or any greater than five. So I would guess it's going to be two, three, or four. I certainly know that we're looking at photo ID might be one we might end up placing on the ballot.
Thank goodness, 80% of the state of Minnesota wants photo ID. I don't know what Mark Dayton's thinking of. He vetoed that one as well.
It does, and I'll tell you that freedom of employment, Sue, it's approaching 75%. We're over 70% support in Minnesota for the freedom of employment language, at least an abbreviated form of what we have in House File 65. So I'm very confident, again, if this gets placed on the ballot, as with photo ID, that there are going to be two that Minnesotans would like to see guide the future of their state.
So if we have three ballot questions on our ballot when we go in November of 2012, are we going to turn into California?
Well, we certainly are not. California's got initiative and referendum, and the people can form groups in order to go around. And
that's a big difference. Initiative and referendum versus a constitutional question on the ballot.
Here in Minnesota, what we need to do is the legislature needs to pass a proposal through both houses. The governor does not get a chance to sign or veto it. It goes directly to the ballot, but it is completely different. I should mention this, too. I expect we're going to see some sort of measure entertained around either limiting the ability of the legislature to raise taxes or to spend, and that would be the other one that is in the mix. But before we go,
I want to ask you about the possibility of limiting the spending or tax increases or whatever. Are you talking about a taxpayer bill of rights?
Maybe something like Tabor, but also maybe we've talked about maybe limiting, making a supermajority requirement to raise taxes, or maybe a supermajority to spend. Maybe Governor Plenty's idea of not being able to spend more than you took in the previous biennium. Those are the types of ideas we're looking at around there.
Very good ideas.
Good stuff. So those are the four ideas probably that are most prevalent. I should mention the polling that has been done around this freedom of employment question. And Public Opinion Strategies has done two very significant polls in the last 6 months, one in July, one recently in early December. And they have found that freedom of employment or right to work back in July had about 68% support in the state. The most recent one, December, has 73% for the actual language that would or could appear on the ballot. That means 69% of union members, 69% of union members would like the freedom of employment. So we really need to work forward to bring them this freedom and bring this forward for Minnesota and in our economic future.
That's an unbelievable number, 69%.
Exactly.
I mean, we've just got to get this done. So if there's that much overwhelming support for this legislation, why can't we convince Mark Dayton, pass it through the legislature and convince Mark Dayton this is a good idea? Is he just too tied to the unions?
I really don't know. I just know what I see, and the behavior I see in the governor is that he seems to have an allegiance to the unions that won't allow him to go there. And
he must have an allegiance to the union leadership,
not necessarily
to the union members.
Exactly. He's leaving the union members out of the equation and focusing on the leadership. And that political power, again, is exercised by that leadership, and I'm sure they're going there. But you raise a good point. I think I would like to and sit down with the governor and talk about these numbers and things we're seeing and let them know, you know what, union members are in favor of this. We need to give them the opportunity to decide whether they want the freedom or not to join that union.
That I just find that incredible. We saw Governor Dayton make a play to try to unionize the daycare workers. And this made me so angry because what he did by executive order was to call for an election of only the daycare providers that were receiving subsidies from the state of Minnesota. So if there are 11,000 daycare workers, he says, all right, I'm going to decide by executive order that you guys get to vote on this. Only all of you don't get to vote. Just the 4,000 of the 11,000 total get to vote and decide if you want to be unionized. How unfair was that?
You know, it was a very unfair and really an engineered approach to voting, which I think I sense Minnesotans are flatly rejecting that. There's a huge amount of outrage. And Sue, that is part of the fuel, I think, behind what Minnesotans are saying in these polling results we're seeing around freedom of employment. They are rejecting the notion of forced unionization that says, you know what, if you work here, you have to join a union or you're fired. That's basically what we have now. If you don't join this union, you either can't be employed or you're fired. And that's what we have. Minnesotans reject that. And I think that as they see this initiative coming forward from the governor, they're getting a taste of what we have. And they don't like the anti-freedom component of it. And so I think it's really playing in the hands of freedom and free-loving Minnesotans.
I do too. And it helped that the judge told Governor Dayton, yeah, you don't get to do that. You overstepped your authority. You abused your authority. And I hope the legislature will do something to try to protect them. Or maybe the right to work or the freedom of employment, maybe that will take care of that. Will it eliminate Dayton's ability to authorize union votes by executive order?
It won't affect that. That'll happen independently, but should that be successful and should they hold a vote and should the 4,000 daycare workers out of the 11,000 that have been selected vote to have the union and that's successful, of those 4,000 workers, then daycare, I should say business owners,
yes,
would at that point have the freedom to decide whether they want to join the union. If freedom of employment or right to work wouldn't be there, which it is not now, they would be forced to join the union against their will, to pay money to this union against their will, and essentially decrease their take-home pay or their disposable income, which is not what we want to have happen.
Right. And if the governor could come in and determine by executive orders that the daycare workers who were receiving subsidies could vote on becoming members of the union while the other daycare providers couldn't, what group of people would he pick next?
Where is he going next?
Right.
Exactly.
It could be home health care workers. It could be doctors. It could be
construction
anything.
Business workers. Who knows? Yeah, exactly. That's why it's heartening to see that the judge, as you mentioned, has seen the light of day here. And
crushed it.
Well, okay.
He didn't crush it. It was a temporary restraining order.
The governor did not have anything to stand on to begin with, and he's been called out, and the emperor has no clothes at this point.
Yeah. Unfortunately, our attorney general decided to jump on board, and they are going to go through with the appeal with the hearing that's coming up in January of next year. So that'll be interesting.
I anticipate we're going to see freedom of employment polls come close to 80% at that point, Sue.
It's encouraging to see you guys working on legislation like that. You look on the other hand, you've got Mark Dayton making a task force to study obesity, a task force to study bullying, a task force to study health insurance exchanges, a task force to study all these ridiculous things instead of letting the legislature do their job.
Mm-hmm. Well, we are going to do our job, and as I mentioned, there's going to be a variety of reforms coming forward. It's going to be a fun session, a good session for those of us that are liberty-minded, and it's going to be probably the first opportunity, really, in many, many years, 38 years since we've controlled the Minnesota State Senate, since Republicans have controlled the Minnesota State Senate. So it's going to be really the first real I think, display of bills and legislative activity that is going to be geared toward actually reclaiming some of our freedoms instead of the incremental reduction of freedoms that we've seen over many of the past decades.
And just so you know, coming up in the next election, we're going to work real hard to get more conservatives and libertarians elected so that we can get some of this stuff done, because people in Minnesota know that government is too big, too expensive, and too intrusive, and we just have to stop.
It is, and they do know that what we run into, and sometimes I see as a legislator, sometimes it's the resistance, if you will, to some of these measures is greater in government than it is from the other party. I mean, a lot of times you are, you know, the old thing about fighting City Hall. It's amazing. These government bureaucracies are dug in, and they have instant credibility in the discussions in the hearings because they know their area so well, and they bring that to the table. But they continue to fight our ability to bring about reforms, the same reforms that Minnesotans are asking us to bring. But we're steadfast in our effort to do so, and we'll continue on that path.
We're down to our last minute now, and I want you to look into the cameras, and I want you to tell people why the Freedom of Employment Act is going to be so important, why we want to see it on the ballot, and why we're going to support it.
Well, what we have is in Minnesota, we have a situation where we have compulsory or forced union membership. And that means if anybody in Minnesota decides to or is hired by a firm or a government bureaucracy that is unionized, they are required to be a part of that union. And that means they have to give up those union dues, which can be hundreds of dollars. I mean, we're talking about teachers, $750, $800 a year that is taken against their will by unions many times for the union bosses to use in elections and other things that is not part of the mission of the union. So this freedom of employment will give the employee the freedom to decide whether they want to be a member, whether they want to pay those dues or not. And that's the freedom we have in 22 other states in the U.S. It will help us bring forward economic prosperity. It will help job creation grow by a rate of twice of what it is now and has historically in our state. And this is the type of measure we need to bring forward to bring jobs back, to get the 200,000 Minnesotans that currently don't have a job back to be employed again.
We are out of time. If you find yourself agreeing with our guest, you might be a libertarian. To find out, take the world's smallest quiz at www.theadvocates.org. Remember, Libertarian Viewpoint brings you the non-government, liberty-based solutions that other media refuse to tell you about. Liberty works, and it is always the best choice. If anyone in government can prove otherwise, I challenge them to speak up. To view past shows, search YouTube using Libertarian Viewpoint. Thank you for watching, and stay tuned for other shows of Libertarian Viewpoint. Freedom of employment, does it really exist?